Well, hello, boys and girls. It's when we feel like 8 o'clock. I'm Pearl of Wisdom, and you're listening to my NHL Pearls of Wisdom. And you're also listening to Joe Borek, one of the finest writers of the land, right here and now in our environment, coming in our environment a lot lately, actually. Today, we did a whole bunch of prediction stuff. You might want to check it out for the first round of the playoffs with Steel Flyers, by the way. Go check out that fine programming over there at steelflyers.com. Just put up the website. You see all the podcasts we do, all the blogs, everything we do and more, and his own stuff that he does with his wife, who are fantastic together. And we found out we might even be doing that too. So that's kind of cool. Anyways, there is a big rumor in the land going on. Well, actually, Rutherford himself pretty much started it. It's not even a rumor. Some things that we're about to say may be kind of rumorish because we're going to look at maybe what he might be thinking. But Rutherford came out basically, and you can read it out, but I'll say basically that Pittsburgh needs changes and they want to get younger, but they want to stay competitive. Something into the effect of, well, the window is closing, but we don't think it's closed. So we're going to look at what he may do. You want to read that out, Joe?
Yeah, he said, I'll read part of the other one, too, just to say some of the other stuff he said. He said, we got to a certain point in the playoff series, and we realized, basically said, and we're not the same team. We don't have the same drive. We were up against elimination. It was disappointing in game four. You're waiting for that desperation and waiting. It didn't come in the first period. It didn't come in the second period. In the third period, it was even worse. So that's what eventually got him on to eventually say later in his quote with his presser, we have to be careful with how we approach this, he said. We still feel strong with our group of players, especially the core players. This could be a year where we try to get younger, but in a way where we feel we still could win. So basically they want to get younger and free up some cap space with guys, but in a way that they still feel they're going to be competitive and not fall out of competing in the top of the Eastern Conference, per se.
Yeah. It's funny, the first thing that came out that I heard is the trading of Denny Malkin. And I was looking at that possibility. But then when you read it again, it seems to make it quite clear that that's not the case, that Malkin is not on the table. They're not thinking of trading him or anything of that nature. It seems, I did look at it, and I'll say it really quick. If they were to, the only team I could find that would make sense would be Colorado. But it doesn't look like they are. You can go down there and have fun and play fantasy and see what would happen if you went to Colorado, though. I did. It was fun. But I think more than anything, then, we're going to be looking at veterans that are out the door, aren't we?
Yeah. Yeah, I believe there's going to be veterans moved. I mean, I know the Athletic article I read from Josh Yeo, I think is how you say his name. But he said that there's zero chance that, in his opinion, that Sullivan's going to be going along with Malkin and Letang, and then obviously they're not trading Crosby. And Crosby's the only guy that Rutherford actually said. He basically said to the team's leadership role, other than Sidney Crosby, they could have given a little bit more. So Crosby basically was the only guy in the core to him that actually looked good in the playoff series, well, in the play-in series, actually in a leadership role, because he talked about in the other quote I read, no bounce back. They kind of had no spunk to them. Like, once something happened for Montreal, it's like a team that normally had a lot of spunk to them all of a sudden had no bounce back. And that's not something you normally see from Pittsburgh.
Yeah. Well, and I think a lot, and I mentioned this before, that I personally think part of this deal is that the whole thing with Fleury leaving and Matt Murray taking over, he didn't handle it well. The team didn't handle it well. It doesn't look like it went well. I think it really affected Matt Murray. And for whatever reason, for professionals, but professionals still have emotions and thoughts and all that kind of stuff like that. It certainly seems to me that one of the places they're likely going to be going to get some cap room for possible free agents is their goaltending. Matt Murray is a restricted free agent. He'd have to be traded. I don't know what kind of return. I imagine there's a team out there that's going to want to give him a shot and would be willing to give him a pick to give. Cause, I mean, he won two cups at 26 years old. I mean, you can't take that away.
Well, he's also a restricted free agent. And if you have a good, if you have a GM that knows how to negotiate and talk about all the nooks and crannies of the season, he's going to say, you're coming off of your least productive season. We're going to give you a contract here to prove it if you traded for his rights for a couple years. And then if you do good for that two-year contract, then we obviously want to invest in you because you would still only be about 28 going on 29 at that point. So right. You still have many great years of Murray left if he gets it back. And I don't see any reason to think if he gets a change of scenery why he's going to continue to struggle. I think this is just he started struggling. Maybe a change of scenery is probably what's actually best for him.
Yeah, I think so too. And then, of course, back to goaltending again. Now you got to sign Tristan Jarry.
Correct.
However, it's his first contract. I don't think you're going to have to give him too much at this point, right? Maybe a two-year, $5 million contract or something like that. And then you'll have, and then sign either bring DeSmith up. Or they wonder if they're comfortable with those two?
Give him a shot. I would think so. Yeah. The reason I would think so is just because he was supposed to be their backup this year, and then the cap didn't allow him to be their backup this year. Like, Jarry literally had his prove it season because the cap of the Penguins was so bad that they couldn't fit DeSmith. So then he did so well. And now it's, okay, now we can fit the Smith and we can get rid of Matt Murray. Tristan, now we need you to be so great so we can just have Casey be that great backup. So instead, and not play 35 games or 40. So it's like, so I feel like they probably would be comfortable just because before the season it seemed like they really liked how the Smith was playing. It's just they literally had no room for him. And that I remember reading multiple stuff about that on The Athletic in different spots. And it was unfortunate for them. I don't know how they probably didn't realize that earlier than they did, rather than, oh, crap, we can't fit this guy on. But it worked out fine for them. But that's not the most surprising thing. The most surprising thing I read in this article, and I wanted to get your real reaction to it, so I didn't bring it up before the video, is Rutherford criticized the public beating that Jack Johnson receives on social. And that's why he directed shots at Justin Schultz. So Rutherford, in repeating what he told The Athletic in May, said keeping both goaltenders Murray and Jarry will be difficult, obviously. But he also said that changes will be made. But he directed, literally, I can't find the exact quote on Schultz, but he insulted Justin Schultz and just continues to, which he's been doing for a while now, defend Jack Johnson. When it comes to his public bashing he gets from the Pittsburgh faithful.
For being a bad defenseman?
So.
That sounds like a general manager. That sounds to me like a general manager that's stuck in a contract and wants to get the best out of possible out of the contract they have. So he doesn't think that he's going to be able to trade that away. Or he is even better than that. Doing a Jedi mind trick on other general managers, making Jack Johnson not the problem. It was all Justin Schultz. So, hey, why don't you give me a call and we'll see if we can work something out. Because and Rutherford is great that way. I mean, he's made, look at some of the great trades that Rutherford has made. He did a fantastic job with Carolina, not necessarily with their farm system, but I mean, he certainly put a team together and did so well. So I think that's what it is. Because no matter how you spin it, Mr. Rutherford, if I'm a general manager, I'm laughing if you're calling on the phone. There's no way I'm touching Jack Johnson. Forget about it. No, not happening. And if Jack Johnson can't handle a couple of the fan or the media pressure that is on him for being a bad defenseman, well. That.
Yeah, but this is also what he said about Pittsburgh, because this is kind of what this video, we were kind of saying what their issues is and what they should do. He said their biggest issue is having, he said, different ideas, different approaches. Younger, determined players. Usually you're searching and you say you've got to find a player or two. We have enough guys that the power play should be successful. It's so frustrating to watch us not get scoring chances, let alone goals. 5-on-3 in game one, we don't really get any good chances. You don't have to be around hockey long to watch the guys we have on the ice and just be puzzled. There are a number of things we have to try to change. So basically, saying
I totally agree. I saw a scared team. And I honestly think that'll be fixed best with better goaltending more than anything. I think that's the biggest problem. I don't know if Rutherford sees that or if he doesn't want to do, you know, maybe Jari is the answer for now, but I think goaltending, if Jari's not a fit, then they're in trouble. You know, if Jari's not going, can't do it again. He put up good numbers, but now we're talking about number one, right? Jari as a number one. Is Jari ready to be a number one right now? I'm not sure.
Is he. I don't think he is either, actually. Because he said, my assessment is that Tristan had an exceptional first half, made the All-Star team. Matt was the better in the second half. So my assessment on goaltending is the playoffs, that both were good, he basically said, and I can't point a finger on the goalies. The problem was that we had goaltending and that we had great goaltending that makes a difference. So basically, he basically said that as the – basically, I think he meant the problem was – because he said literally the problem was we had great goaltending, good goaltending, and that makes a difference. But I think he meant that's a problem when you can't win when your goaltenders still played well. I think that's what he was trying to say by that point.
I don't agree. I don't think Murray played well at all. Did you think Murray played well? He looked out of position a lot.
I didn't think he played that great in the playoffs. That's why I'm surprised by that part of the quote, because if I was looking at the two, I would favor Jari right now over Matt Murray for the purpose of one going forward just for Pittsburgh, because I think Matt Murray, like we said, needs a little bit of a change of scenery and would benefit them.
And he's going to get it. Somebody will give him a chance. And Murray's got all the skill in the world. It's just
fine somewhere else. I literally think he's one of those guys that just sometimes you just, for some reason, can't explain why he starts struggling elsewhere, and then he goes to another location, and it just snaps it in again, and has a good goalie coach, good system there, and it just works.
I think,
like Carolina,
when Fleury left, like maybe the pressure of being like when Fleury was there, you're under an umbrella, right? Right, you've got, and then when he's gone, now you're the guy, and it just didn't handle it well. Like it was a little bit awkward to all kinds of stuff that may be going on there. So, anyways, he's still saying he wants to get younger. You got guys in the lineup like Patrick Hornquist, who's got 5.3 for the next 3 years, got 32 points this year. I've heard everywhere that they like Hornquist a lot. I don't know if he would consider core, but he didn't bring up his name. Do you think there's a place for Hornquist out there? Do you think there's a market out there for him?
I think with the type of player he is, he's a guy that you want to have as you're rounding out and getting into those tenacious parts of the season, because you know Hornquist is a guy that takes no issue with getting under the skin of the other team while also providing Nefron's presence and being a solid scorer. So, yeah, I mean, I think he would definitely have to have a market. I mean, 32 points in 52 games ain't nothing to be shy about. And he also was one of their – he wasn't the best defensively, I guess, in the playoffs, but the whole team wasn't. So, but he was one of their better guys. He actually had 2 points in the 4 games. So, I mean – he would definitely have a market. It would definitely be interesting to see if he's one of the veterans Rutherford was thinking of, since, like you said, he's commented at how much he's liked him in the past. So it would definitely be interesting if he's going to go from saying, I love this guy, to going, oh, well, because I now changed my opinion, let me trade him. But it would make sense for their cap. He would be the guy I would peg to, because, like I said before the video, the only other guy you have that has around that same cap hit that you would get value for is Zucker, but why the hell would you trade Jason Zucker when you just got him and you have him locked up for 5-5 and he's only 28 until 2022-23? Like that wouldn't make much sense when you're saying you want to stay younger. I mean, who knows? I mean, that's the guy that I would peg, unless if you're trading the only other guy and he's not older, but if you want to get a different center, you can save 3-5 is kind of, I mean, because I know how much they love Brian Russ. I don't think there's a chance that Pittsburgh would get rid of Brian Russ. That's like a guy that's in the perfect situation for him. He also
way they'll get rid of Brian Russ.
Yeah, he had 56. He was a points per game player this year. I mean, there's no chance. And he also was their best offensive guy in the. He had 3 points in the playoffs in the 4 games. So he's pretty much a points per game player there. So, I mean, Rust is a guy I just think that they love so much. There's no chance of getting rid of him. It's just those guys and Dumoulin. Huh. They want to trade Dumoulin, but he's 28. So that's a hard guy to swallow trading.
I don't see that either. If they were to go Hornquist, you got like somebody in the ballpark of being youngish that they could look at as somebody that might play well with Crosby or Malkin is Tyler Toffoli.
I don't know how much money you would actually save there, though, because Toffoli is...
You're not saving money, no. But you're getting rid of Hornquist and bringing another player back at $6 million, something like that, somewhere around there, maybe. Do you think somebody's going to give Toffoli $7 million? If they do, I guess I'm out, but...
Unfortunately, I feel like... Well, it's good that you guys fixed your management core in Edmonton, because if you had your same management core, you guys seem like in the free agency sometimes to be the team that wouldn't always get the people, but would be like, oh, there's no way this guy's going to sign with us, so let's offer him $7 million. And then every Oilers fan's like, I really like this player, but please don't sign with us. I don't want you for $7.5 million. Like, accept someone else's contract. So we don't need to have you for $7.5 million.
Yeah. Like there's, there's some cheaper guys like Nemeshnikov that you might be able to get for $3 million or something like
Foley,
that.
I don't think will get paid $7 million. That would surprise me with the cap staying flat.
No, I don't think so either. He might even take a short-term contract in order to get past this whole thing. So it might not be a bad thing to look at. I'm just looking at some guys and maybe they could fill the roster out with that are younger. Maybe he's thinking about Matthias Janmark. I wouldn't be my pick, but didn't put up much numbers in Nashville. But maybe if he played with a better center, he might put up some decent numbers. Josh Levo, you know, they could start getting a depth type roster.
Well,
they bringing in a lot of depth guys to play with their.
Yeah, I was going to say, though, we have to remember for Tanev, I think the reason he could be traded is he does have the modified no trade, but he could be moved because all he has is he submits a 10-team no trade list. Is Bukestad is coming back, so he could also be moved. So if you're not going to move, he only has 1 year on his deal. You could pick between one of those two. He's probably movable with 1 year on his deal coming back from injury because somebody would give him a shot for 1 year.
Bukestad?
Yeah, becoming
UFA. Yeah, you're not going to get any value out of him, but no, somebody like, might take him for 1 year, maybe.
Yeah, you're not going to get a lot of value, but we're not really talking about, per se, getting a lot of value. We're more talking about opening up their cap, in a sense, so they can add value also, potentially, via the free agent market, because that would add a lot of, that would add the cap space to help you get a Tyler Toffoli and not have to worry about all the other stuff and having your cap still be strapped and all messed up because you just signed Tyler Toffoli and now you have no money for anything else. So,
let's go to their defense now. We haven't really solved much except, you know, maybe you could trade Hornquist off and then you could fill out that role. I don't think they're getting rid of Brandon Tanev, honestly. I think they just love him. I'm not sure anybody else.
They do. My problem is teams have to trade people they love when they're so cap strapped, and Pittsburgh is kind of one of those teams that, like Rutherford said, just have to figure it out. And I don't know if they're
You're going to get back for him to the value that he has for the team at $3.5 million for till he's 35 is not worth it. But who knows? I suppose. I just can't see it. I think that would be counterproductive to what they're trying to do. Probably Ivan Rodriguez, you can trade off. He's a restricted free agent. Somebody will pick him up for a middle round pick or something like that. You know, those kind of guys, and then kind of restructure and see if you can find some diamonds in the rough with that money. Dominic Simone at a minimum. But really where is going to be interesting, I think, is going to be Justin Schultz, pretty clearly. Did you already mention it from the article that he's likely not back?
Yeah, Rutherford takes shots at him and always defends Johnson, so there's no chance that Schultz is going to be back. I think he also honestly likes who's a restricted free agent, Yuso Ricola.
Ricola, yeah.
Ricola, yeah, more than Schultz, who had a solid season as a left-handed defenseman at 26 years old. I mean, 7 points, 6 assists in 36 games, also played decent on the other end defending. So, I mean, he's a guy that you're going to get what you get from him. But, I mean, yeah, I mean, I would keep him over Justin Schultz. You're saving a lot of money. So I would say keep Rico, get rid of Schultz. That saves you a lot of money there. But because they want to save more money, it's unfortunate. Like we said, you're not going to be able to trade Jack Johnson. You might have to trade Dumoulin if you want to free up cap, because you're not trading Pettersson. You just signed Marcus Pettersson, so why would you trade him as soon as you sign? So, like, they don't want to do that. They love him. But like I said, you're going to have to pick between someone you probably like to trade if you want to free up the cap. It seems like Rutherford wants to free up to sign some guys to stay good and get younger, because in the free agency, it's not just Tyler Toffoli that's 28 and available. You have some other guys. They have to add to their defense, too. And you have guys on defense. I don't think Carolina's going to keep all the guys they have. I don't think they're Pete Bodnin. So if that's somebody they like, they could get him at 29. They could get Cody Ceci, who's 26 only.
I like a value pickup of Forbert. I really do like Forbert. I think he's a good value pickup.
Derek Forbert, yeah, that's a good pickup, too. And he's only 30, I think, 29-30. So, I mean, yeah, they have a lot of defensemen you can pick up, too. So if you want to free up cap, you're going to have to make very difficult decisions with this team just because of where your cap's going to be and all that. I mean, Tristan Yarry, $5 million, you put that on there. They only had 13-something. That's taken a big chunk out of it. And if you're not going to buy out Jack Johnson, which from how Rutherford talks, if I had to make a prediction from off of his words then, I would say they're not.
Yeah. So, but, I mean, like I said, I want what he did with said about Jack Johnson. I mean, he could be also taking the heat off of Jack Johnson in the hockey world in order to do something with him, because he can blame Schultz, who he doesn't plan on re-signing anyways, for all of Jack Johnson's problems a little bit, get it in the general manager's head, and maybe find a general manager that'll pick him up. I don't think it matters what he says. Nobody's taking Jack Johnson's contract.
No, but like I said, the teams are in far worse situations. You can have guys that you paid $10 million that still produce but want $10 million guys and have that issue rather than having a guy that's not playing well that gets paid $3.2 million.
Yeah,
there's teams that are a little bit worse contract situations where the guy gets paid way more. Like Kessler, if he wasn't injured at the end of his career here for the Ducks, still gets paid a lot of money if he wasn't injured and on long-term IR. Obviously, if he wasn't injured, Ryan Kessler would still not be worth that contract at this point of his career. So, like, it's guys always have – every team – tends to have a terrible contract every so often. But
okay, so this is what we got, boys and girls. We're going to finish her up here. Matt Murray's not coming back.
I agree. Yeah,
Schultz
agree.
Justin Schultz is definitely not coming back. Jack Johnson is likely coming back. Sorry about that, Pittsburgh fans. Hornqvist, what do you say? Lean that he stays?
I'm going to say, because of, like I said, tough decisions, I'm going to say he probably gets traded because he's going to have to be – he's just the one that you look to that seems like the most simple, toughest decision because he's going on 34. Even though you like him, if you think you're going to really like how Zucker develops as he has these more years on his contract, too, until the after 2023, I believe, then you have a much better thing there with a 28-year-old. So I believe he will still go in the end, but it's going to be interesting because of their love for him. It's just tough decisions need to be made.
So. Yeah, it'd be interesting to see where he may go. Off the top of my head, I can't really think of a place that is going to take a $5.3 million contract at 32 points for a 33-year-old. It would have to be a special situation where he would end up going there. He has an NTC. It's only an 8-team NTC, but if he can pick out like teams that likely would be able to take him and say, I'm not going there, and make it very difficult on them. But if they work out a deal or something, then I could see him going to get a guy like Toffoli, who's younger and speedier, has more speed than Hornqvist does. But yeah, I'm leaning towards him being traded based on the fact that they can get a guy like Toffoli. If I was Toffoli, I'd want to go there. It'd be great for your career to play with Crosby and all that.
Oh, yeah, 100%. You want to go to, if you have the opportunity to play with those guys, you are signing that contract, and he's going to get paid a pretty good amount of money. An interesting guy, if they could open up money for him, obviously as a fan of the Flyers, I don't want to see this happen in any way, shape, or form, but that's why I think they would debate moving some other guys too, is I wouldn't be shocked if Pittsburgh's looking at the fact that Mike Hoffman's in the free agency and only 30 years old.
Oh, well, yeah. I thought about Hoffman too, but I think he's going to be out of their price range. I think a guy that consistent 30-goal scorer is here, Montreal's all over him, and that makes sense because they're a shoot-first type team, and he's got that high percentage shooting percentage. So I think,
and if they're not going after Toffoli, they could, because if you're going to trade Hornqvist for somebody that will produce more points, but for like maybe a 3-year deal, even though Dadanoff isn't young, he's still a very good consistent player. You might be able to get him for 3 years, and he would be a more points producer than Hornqvist at this point of both of their careers.
I think if he could get to down, if he'd take a good look at it, but there's going to be a lot of people going after to down.
Oh, true. Yeah. No, I completely agree.
Again, I think he's going to get priced out.
Yeah.
I think he's going to get priced out. He can put up a point a game possibly still in his career. So, I think he's going to get priced out. Well, boys and girls, there we have it. I don't know how many questions we answered in your heads, but we had a lot of fun doing this. Tell me what you think Pittsburgh's going to do. What do you think they should do? Do you think Rutherford's out of his head? Maybe they should trade Malkin. It's time. Maybe it's time. I think possibly it is. Do you think it's possible that it is, Joe? Whether he thinks so or not?
It might be, because he's the guy we've heard in rumors so much. He only has 2 years left on his deal. And I think if it doesn't happen this year, they're probably going to be trying to do it next year. And it's very hard to move somebody for anything in the last year of their contract.
Yeah.
Because a team's only getting them for the last year, usually not giving up to all too much at that point.
Yeah. Rutherford is a guy who is very imaginative when it comes to building a hockey team. He seems to not make too many mistakes when adding to his team. He knows what identifies players that are going to work in the system. It hasn't worked out recently, but in Carolina, it sure worked out. It worked out here in Pittsburgh once or twice. Did he win? I think two he won here. So, I mean, he does his thing. But it's a lot of fun seeing what maybe they may do, and I enjoyed this. Thank you, Joe, for coming in and doing this again. I want to do more stuff like this, Joe. I enjoyed it. We'll do it for Steel Flyers podcast website and maybe your podcast with
the said, we'll probably do some fun free agent videos and different stuff like that. That would be fun too, I think, to talk about different guys on the market. Toffoli will probably be one of them.
Yeah. Yes, Toffoli's one of them. That's what we'll do. We're going to watch out. Stay on the edge of your seats. We're going to do a Where Are They Going series. It's going to be all the frolic in the world, boys and girls. Thank you for coming in. I've been Pearlo. This has been Joe Borek, and he's one of the finest writers in the land. You can find him on Flyers Nitty Gritty. He writes for, tell him all about it.
Pub Sports Radio, Overtime Heroics, and then Philly, Sports Fanatic News, spelled with a P for Philly, is my YouTube channel with our true Philadelphian sports cast that this fine gentleman, Pearlo, always appears on. And it's been really fun talking about Pittsburgh's team today and seeing what they're going to do with their team. And hopefully, for their fans' sake, obviously I'm not a fan of Pittsburgh, but for their fans' sake, they figure it out and get their cap in order, because their cap is not in the best order right now. And I see what Rutherford's saying. I just don't seem to agree with some of the players he seems to want to keep. And
I'm totally with you in every capacity, because we're both Philadelphia Flyers fans, and I really don't care if they win. Okay, bye. Have a great day, everyone. Lots of love to you.
Yeah.